First, I would like to thank the organizers for this conference, and in particular Andreas for making my trip possible. I really appreciate to be here, and I think it's really perfect for the topic, because the first thing I actually thought about this topic was in Japan. So I was in Japan 1.5 years ago, and I thought about this topic, so it's good to present it in a Japan-Korean conference. So I want to explain you this picture. My goal is to explain you the picture. I'm not sure I will go on to the picture, but at least I will explain you what is an asociahedra. So the first thing I want to tell you is a little bit of motivation for this topic. And the motivation is to construct polytopes from combinatorics and to explain combinatorics with geometry. So let me first remind you what is a polytope. So a polytope is just a convex object. But the important thing is that it's described by a finite number of things. So you can describe it in two ways, which are sort of they're equivalent, not computationally, but at least mathematically they're equivalent. So the first way you can describe a polytope is as a convex hull of a finite number of points in RD, so we are in a d-dimensional space. Or you can define it as an intersection of finitely many half spaces. So for example, the cube, you can define it as a convex hull of these 8 points, or as an intersection of these 6 hyperplanes. So I will always try to give you both descriptions. So the first description is called the vertex description, and the second is called the H description for hyperplane description. So I will try to give you both. And what interests me in the polytopes is not really the geometry of it. So meaning, imagine you take this red face, this red facet, and move it a little bit up, then for me, nothing changed. So the combinatorics is still the same. So what interests me is the combinatorics of the polytope. So meaning, how are the faces related? So remember that a face is just the intersection of a polytope with a supporting hyperplane, and I'm interested in that object, which is just an inclusion poset of the faces. So you see the vertices here, the edges on the second level, and the facets on the third level. And I always take the empty face on bottom and the full polytope on top. And this way I get a lattice. So the face lattice of the polytope, and this is what interests me. And if I move one of the faces up a little bit, so this red face up a little bit, then I don't change the right side. So for me, it's the same polytope. So usually what people in polytope are interested in is they take the points, they give me a set of points, and I want to understand the face lattice of the convex hull of these points. And what I do is sort of the contrary. So I will give you the lattice, so I will give you that. And my goal is to understand whether I can find a set of points such that the convex hull of this point set has this face lattice. This is more or less the motivation. So let me give you an example. And the example is that of the permutahedron. So the permutahedron is obtained as a convex hull of the points. So these points are just obtained by you look at each permutations and you think of it as a point in the vector. In the vector space. So I looked at permutations in n plus 1, of 1 up to n plus 1, and I looked at each permutation as a point in Rn plus 1, and I take the convex hull of these points. So here's an example with n equal 2. Okay? So one thing that you have to observe is that all these points, say, the sum of the coordinates of this point is always the same. So I always, all these points are in this hyperplane, which I will always denote by this H stuff. And so this is the reason why I call it perm n. It's because the dimension is n. And the second thing that you have to see in this slide is that you can actually, so the first line is a vertex description of this polytope. And you can actually describe it by a very simple facet description. And in this facet description, this black H of J is it's a set of points such that the sum of the coordinate in this set J is bigger than J plus 1 choose 2. So somehow this white H is so you see that they are really close to each other, except here I take inequalities and here I take inequality. Okay, this is these things. Okay, so here you see the example in dimension 2, and so here you see the example in dimension 3. So again, I have taken the permutation of 1, 2, 3, 4 and the convex hull of these permutations. And the face lattice of this permutahedron is also very nice. So the faces correspond to ordered partitions of n plus 1. If you want a k face, then you should take n plus 1 minus k parts. So for example, if you want a zero face, so a vertex, you should take an ordered partition of n plus 1 into n plus 1 parts, which is just a permutation. Okay, so you take a partition into n plus 1 parts and the parts are ordered. If you want a facet, so you should take something of dimension n minus 1, because the intrinsic dimension is n. So it would give you something, an ordered partition of n plus 1 into 2 parts, and this is just a subset. So the number of facets is 2 to the n minus 2. Okay, and you can see these ordered partitions, this is what I did in the picture, as surjections from n plus 1 to n plus 1 minus k. So here, these things means that the 1 is sent to 1, 2 is sent to 2, 3 is sent to 1, and 4 is sent to 2. And the inclusion order between this, let's say, between the partition is just a refinement order. So you partition, and if you can refine, then you get a containment of faces. So here you start to see that with the geometry you can encode some combinatorics, but you can really see many things from the permutation group, from the symmetry group, in this picture. So this is the sort of the goal of this thing. So you can see, I started making a list, but of course it's not finished, so let me just comment a little bit this list. So you can see the inversion sets in this of the permutation. So remember that an inversion is a pair of ij such that sigma of I, so I is smaller than j, but sigma of I is bigger than sigma of j. Right? So the images are inverse. And the inversions correspond to being in certain on certain side of hyperplanes in this picture. So let me rather comment on the second point, which is easier to see. So the weak order on permutation is the inclusion order of the inversion sets. So you look at two permutations, compute the inversion sets of the two permutations, and if the inversion set of the first one is included in the inversion set of the second one, you say that the first permutation is below the second one in the weak order. Okay, so this is the weak order on permutations. And this weak order, you can see it in this picture. So how does it work? You take the identity permutation here, 1, 2, 3, 4, and you take the permutation where everything is reversed, so it's on top there. I think there is a pointer, but anyway. So this 4, 3, it's that maybe. Okay, great. This 4, 3, 2, 1 permutation is everything reversed. So the set of inversions is every pair is an inversion there. And now you orient your polytope in that direction, from 1, 2, 3, 4 to 4, 3, to 1. And so you orient the edges in that direction. So this edge will go from here to here and so on. So this way. Okay? And what you obtain is an acyclic graph, and it's a Hasse diagram of this weak order. So you see already that all these things about inversion, you can see it in this picture. Then you can read reduced expressions of permutations. So for example, this permutation 3, 4, 2, 1, I can read its reduced expression. So what I do is I only look in this Hassel diagram, which I just defined. So in this oriented graph from 1, 2, 3, 4 to 4, 3, to 1, I look at the passes. So for example, I have a pass here. So here, 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 and here. And I look at all possible passes in this oriented graph, and this gives me all possible reduced expressions. So for this element, for example, I will have 4 reduced expressions. You can have a look at it while I'm talking. Then you can look at what are called bread moves. So bread moves in the symmetric groups are when you have transposition II plus 1. So let's call this 2i. Then 2i, 2i plus 1, 2i is equal to 2i plus 1, 2i, 2i plus 1. And this bread move is just a move in one of these polygons. So when you have this reduced expression, so the one which I just described before, you can make a bread move and go through that side of this hexagon. This is a bread move, and so on. So you can see the coset of the symmetric group and many other things of the group inside this picture. So this is for the motivation, and now let's go to the associahedron. So the associahedron is also a polytope constructed like which encodes some combinatorics. So it encodes the combinatorics of the dissections of a polygon. So you take an n plus 3 gon in convex like a convex n plus 3 gon, and look at the dissections of this n plus 3 gon, and you look at these dissections ordered by refinement, and this gives you a poset. It's a lattice, and I want a polytope whose face lattice is exactly this lattice. So let me translate a little bit. So it means that the vertices, so I always take the, so there is a little confusion, which is that I don't take this poset that I just described, but the reverse one. So I will look for a polytope whose vertices correspond to the triangulations of my polygon, and whose flips correspond to edges, sorry, whose edges correspond to flips between these triangulations. So for example, let me take an interesting example, let's say here. So I pick this, so I have this triangulation and I pick this edge, and I want to flip it, so I remove it. I create a foregone, so I just glue two triangles. And in this foregone, I just deleted one diagonal, so I can decide that I add the other diagonal. And this is what is called a flip. Okay, so I want my polytope I want the graph of the polytope to encode these flips. Okay, and so on and so forth. So if I keep going, then the faces will correspond to certain dissections. So in this picture, in dimension 3, the facets, so the, for example, this facet here, this 5 points, let me take the pointer again. So this facet here, so this pentagon, correspond to all triangulations which contain that diagonal. You see it? So all triangulation containing that diagonal correspond to this facet. And so these are the pentagonal facets. They look like this. And the square facet here, it corresponds to all triangulations containing precisely that diagonal. Okay? So it keeps going this way. So one thing that I will use a little bit is that so this in particular the vertices of this polytope are counted by the Catalan numbers. And in fact, I explain you everything in the world of triangulations and dissections, but you can explain everything in any other Catalan family. So let's just speak a little bit about binary trees. So you can, when you have a triangulation, let me draw the triangulation this way for. So imagine I have a triangulation here. Then I can also look at the dual tree of this triangulation. So this tree is rooted because I have drawn my triangulation this way. And this tree is a binary tree. So I can, instead of looking at triangulation, I can look at binary trees. And then the flip corresponds to what is called rotations in binary trees. And the dissections correspond to Schroeder trees. So there are trees where every node has either zero or more, strictly more than one child. So this is the condition for Schroeder trees. Okay, so here is what I said. So the isosahedron is a polytope which encodes these dissections. And when I say the isosahedron, it's a bit cheating. So of course you can find many different realizations of this polytope. So to give you an example, I took a picture from a paper by Cesar Ceballos, Francisco Santos, and Günther Ziegler, where they draw many different combinatorial realizations of the isosahedron in dimension 3. So they do it in such a way that they are obtained from a cube by just cutting some faces. So you see that you, in all these pictures, you have three pairs of parallel faces. And okay, I said at the beginning that I just care about the combinatorics. So the combinatorics is always the same, and it's what I just described before. So it's this poor set of dissections. But here there's a little bit more of a combinatorics that you can discuss, because you have an identified pair of parallel facets. So I can still say that these realizations are different combinatorially. The reason is, let me pick an example. Here you have a point. In this example, you have a point which is in none of the pairs of parallel facets. Okay, so it's a point which is not on the border of the cube. You see it? And in this copy, for example, you don't have such a point. So you can still say that these two are different combinatorially. It's not really important to understand, but it's just to tell you that you can refine the notion of combinatorial equivalence that I have here. Anyway, so the goal of this slide is to tell you that you have many ways to construct the isosahedron, and actually you have many papers constructing the isosahedron. So I started a list. The list starts actually before, so this is the first so Carl Lee had the first published version, but you have some papers, some unpublished papers before. Something which is forgotten in this slide is that this description of the combinatorics of the isosahedron comes from Stashev, so it's also called the Stashev polytope. So you have interesting constructions which are actually much more general. So here it's about secondary polytopes. I will not enter details. Then I jumped a lot of them, and this one is a survey on these constructions. So they compare different constructions. What interests me in this talk is actually the second line. So it's a line started by Laudet, Jean-Louis Laudet, in 2004 with algebraic motivations. And it's sort of a line of generalizations of constructions. They all are in the same flavor, and I will try to keep going in this flavor. So let me show you first Laudet's realization. So if you have something to remember from this talk, it's maybe how simple you can get an isosahedron. So here is a description. So it's really, in one slide you have the description. Actually you have two descriptions. One, the first one is the vertex description, and the second line is the facet description. So the vertex description goes as follows. I tell you I want a polytope whose vertices correspond to the triangulations. So I just give you a certain point, which I call L of T for Laudet. So I just give you one point for each triangulation, and at the end I take the convex sum of these points. So this L of T is defined here. So I pick a triangulation T here, and I will define a vector in, so it's a triangulation of the n plus trigon. So the first vertex here is called 0, the last is called n plus 2. So in the middle I have n plus 1 vertices. So these are the vertices which interest me. So leftmost I don't care, the rightmost I don't care, I care about the n plus 1 in the middle. And so for each j in n plus 1, I will compute a coordinate. And the coordinate is just a product. So how does it work? I look at, so I have this j, and there is a unique triangle ijk where I is smaller than j and j is smaller than k. So triangulation is fixed, and there is a unique triangle in this triangulation with this property. So this defines me I and k. And now this j's coordinate of the Laudet point associated to this triangulation T is just a product of j minus I by k minus j. Okay? So this is the definition. And then you take the convex sum of these points and you obtain a polytope. And Laudet's observation and beautiful construction is that this is actually an isosahedron. And now you can also describe it by the inequalities. So the first thing which is not obvious is that we are still in this hyperplane that I defined before. So we are in dimension n, even if it looks like we are in dimension n plus 1, but we are in dimension n. And so I have to give you one inequality per diagonal. So remember that I told you that each facet corresponds to an internal diagonal of the polygon. So for each internal diagonal, so let's say this diagonal delta, I just look at all points of my polygon which are below it. So it's an interval. And this gives me a certain set which I should call below of delta, so set below of delta. And so this is B of delta, this is B of delta. And then I just look at this inequality, which is exactly the one I had for the permutahedron, except I don't take all of them, I only take some of them. So one corresponding to this diagonal delta. Okay, so I look at all diagonals, it gives me a bunch of sets. And for each set, I have an inequality. Okay, so this is maybe one thing you should remember for this talk is that it's very simple to get an isosahedron. Okay, so another thing that you should remember see from this slide is that the inequality description of this isosahedron is a subset of the inequality description of the permutahedron. Oh, I missed a slide. So sorry, I forgot to say that all what I said, I can also see it on the trees. So I can, all what I said here, I can take the dual binary trees of the triangulations. I can forget the triangulations, and this is actually Lode's description. So how does it work? I have a binary tree here, and the first thing I have to tell you is how to find the labels of the vertices. So each triangle ijk with I smaller than j smaller than k is labeled by j. Okay, so the dual vertex, the dual node of the binary tree of this triangle is J star. And it seems like you need the triangulation to find this labeling, but it's not true. You can just use the infix order on the tree. So you just go around the tree, and each time you see a node for the second time, then you write the label on it. And then the coordinates that I described, the Lode coordinates, is just the number of leaves in the left child of J multiplied by the number of leaves in the right child of J. So it's also simple to describe it here. Okay, so what I was saying is that this description, this inequality description, is contained in the inequality description of the permutahedron, and this is illustrated in this picture. So I started from a permutahedron in blue, and some of the facets, some of the inequalities interest me. So I keep, so I have in dark blue the facets which still interest me, and the other one I just remove them. Okay, so this is what I did here. So for example, this square facet, you don't see it anymore in the isosahedron, which is in red, so it just disappeared as a facet. Okay, so you can obtain the permutahedron from the isosahedron, and this actually really connects the two objects and give you many many algebraic connections between the two things. So one thing that is a good it's a good moment to introduce the normal fan of a polytope. So when you have the polytope, let's say we pick a two-dimensional polytope. At each vertex, I will look at all, at the normal vectors of all supporting hyperplanes of this vertex. So let's say at that vertex, this vector is a normal vector of a supporting hyperplane of that vertex. So I can keep going, and I would go, so all those vectors are normal vectors of supporting hyperplane. So they form a cone. So if this is vertex V, then this is a normal cone of vertex V. So I can do that everywhere at each vertex. And so the cones are here. And then if I put all these cones together, I obtain what is called, so this is a cone, let's call it W, X and Y. So here I have the cone for W, here I have the cone for V, here I have the cone for Y, and here I have the cone for X. And together it forms what is called a fan, so it's a set of cones which covers the place. The space, sorry, and it's a normal fan of the polytope. So what is written here is that if you take the normal fan of the permutahedron, then it is a refinement of the normal fan of the associahedron, meaning that each normal cone of the associahedron is obtained by gluing some of the cones of the permutahedron. And it also defines the surjection from the permutations to the triangulations, which is just for each permutation, you look at the normal cone of this permutation, and you see where, in which normal cone of the associahedron you arrive. And this gives you just a surjection. I will show an example afterwards. And so, let me show it now. So here is a two-dimensional example. So in blue, you have the permutahedron that I had at the beginning, and in red, you have the associahedron, Lode's associahedron. And you see that the normal cone of this point is obtained by gluing the normal cone of this permutation and the normal cone of this permutation. So these two permutations both are both sent to that triangulation by this surjection. And the last thing which is written here is that actually you can also look in this. So I told you at the beginning, in the blue permutahedron, if you orient everything from the bottommost vertex to the topmost vertex, then you obtain something interesting, which is the Hasse diagram of the weak order. And in the red associahedron, you can also orient everything from the bottommost vertex to the topmost vertex, and you also obtain something interesting. You obtain the Hasse diagram of the Tamari lattice. So the Tamari lattice is a lattice on triangulations, which so you look at the flip. So I just tell you a cover relation in this lattice. So you make a flip, and when you make a flip, you look whether the new diagonal, the slope of the new diagonal is larger or smaller than the slope of the diagonal you flipped. And if it's larger, then you say that you go up in the Tamari lattice. So this orientation, with this orientation from the bottommost vertex to the topmost vertex, you can see the Tamari lattice. And actually, this defines the lattice homomorphism from the weak order to the Tamari lattice. So you can read many things on this construction. So I told you that here. And this was actually the motivation of Lode's construction. Okay, so now that we have seen Lode's construction, let me go to the next construction, which is a construction by Christoph Holweg and Carsten Lange. And the idea is, I think, I'm not sure I made it clear here, but I started everywhere from a triangulation with the topmost edge and everything below. So it's a special polygon. And the idea of Holweg and Lange is, well, we can start from any polygon. So let's start with a polygon. So let's say, for example, let's say this one. So I start from a polygon, so it's an n plus 3 gon, so I put 0 on the left and n plus 2 on the right. And so I now decide for each point from 1 to n plus 1, I decide whether I put it above, in which case I put a little plus, or below, in which case I put a little minus. Okay, this is the only important thing, whether each point is above or below. So if I take only minuses, then I'm back to Lode's realization. If I take plus and minuses, then I get other realizations of the associahedron. So here is an example where it is plus plus minus minus. And these realizations, they are combinatorially equivalent, they are always associahedra, but the normal fans are not the same. So now we distinguish on normal fans. So how does it work? The construction is essentially the same. So again, let me tell you the vertex description and the facet description. So for the vertex description, you see that the so again, I just give you one vertex for each triangulation. So let's pick this triangulation. So the polygon is fixed, and then I pick a triangulation in this polygon, and essentially it looks pretty much the same. So it's essentially again this product formula, except there is a special rule. So it's the same product formula when J is a down vertex. And there is a special rule when J is an up vertex. So again, when J is an up vertex, then I have only one triangle IJK with I smaller than J smaller than K. And again, I compute the number of, I compute J minus I. I mean, it's not really J minus I, it's the number of edges between I and J on this path. And the number I multiply by the number of edges on the boundary of the polygon between J and K. So this is this product, which is still the same as before, but when it's up, then I just take n plus 2 minus this product. So there is a combinatorial reason for that, which I will not explain, but this is the rule. And so this is for the vertex description. Again, it's pretty simple. And I can also give you the facet description. So again, we are in this hyperplane, which is here. So still in the same hyperplane of the permutahedron. And the facets still correspond to diagonals. And the rule is still the same, I mean almost the same. I take whatever is below this diagonal, except if this diagonal has an endpoint on top, then I also take it. Don't ask why, there is a combinatorial reason for that. So it's not that we just tried and obtained that, it's really because there is something behind that. And you take the same hyperplane. So again, it's a polytope obtained from the permutahedron by deleting some facets. So let's have a little break. It's perfect to have a break with Polywood. So it's a chain of movies by Carsten Lange. It's a very short movie, but you start from a permutahedron. So let me start again. Start from a permutahedron, and you take some facets that you don't want, and you start sending them to infinity. And at the end, what you obtain is an associahedron. So this is Lode's construction. So we could still have 20 minutes looking at it, but I have another movie, so we can look at that one too. And this one is the other one with plus, plus, minus, minus that you saw just before. So start from the permutahedron, send some of the facets to infinity, and these facets are determined by the polygon you choose. You send them to infinity and you obtain an associahedron. Okay, so these are the constructions that I start from, and just one little thing that I have to tell you. As before, for the Lode's construction, I told you that you can explain everything on the dual binary trees. You don't need the triangulations. And here is the same. So you can look at the dual trees of these triangulations. And so it's not a binary tree anymore. So you have what you know is that every vertex has a degree 3, but you see that some of them, like the one, like 6, which correspond to a down vertex, they indeed have two children and one father, but the one which correspond to an up vertex, they have two fathers and one child. So somehow you have these two kind of behavior. So it's written here. So the down vertices, they have two children and one father, and the up vertices, they have two father and one children. And you see, if you know I don't find the name anymore of these trees. What's the name of these trees? These kind of trees? There is this rule that any label which is left of J is always smaller than J, and any label which is on the right of J is always bigger than J. But in the father, you don't know. I found it. If you know binary search trees, then you recognize this rule. So you have the same kind of rule on the right. So it's sort of dual binary search trees. So for us, the point is that in such a tree, then you have some of the labels with these rules and some of the labels with that rule. And this only depends on whether you took them plus or minus at the beginning. So anyway, what you have to remember from that is that I can describe what I described before. So the Holweck and Lange coordinate, I can describe it completely on these trees. You don't need to know the details. You will see that afterwards. And here you have trees with some leaves, and I can also, some half edges somehow. They correspond to the boundary edges of the polygon. And the last thing that I wanted to say is that I can also forget these leaves. It will be important for later. So I forget these leaves and I just adapt a little bit the rule. You don't need to see the rule in details. Okay, so let's keep going with the motivation. So at one point I will arrive to my own work. So the motivation is about graph as a shahedron. So what is a graph as a shahedron? It's something associated to a graph. So you start from a graph which is fixed on a ground set V, and you will call a tube on, it should be G here, a tube on G is just a connected induced subgraph of G. So this is a tube, for example, but for example, 1, 9 is not a tube, it's not connected. Okay, and you have a notion of compatibility between tubes. So you say that two tubes are compatible if either they are nested or they are disjoint and non-adjacent, meaning that the union of these two tubes is not the tube again. So let's look at that. For example, if I take the tube, so this tube and the tube 0, 2, they are not compatible because their union is again a tube. Okay? But this tube and the tube just 0 are compatible. Okay? So here is a set of tubes which are pairwise compatible. And I will be interested in this kind of sets. So I look at the nested complex on G, which is the simplified complex of sets of pairwise compatible tubes. So this is an example of such a set. So in other words, it's a clique complex on the compatibility relation. If you don't know what is a clique complex, you don't need to understand that. Just think that I take all sets of pairwise compatible tubes. So the ground set, so the vertices of the simplified complex are just the tubes, and the maximal sets are the maximal nested sets, so the maximal sets of pairwise compatible tubes. And the G as a shahedron is a polytope which realizes this complex. So it was first constructed by Kahn and de Vados, with motivation coming from the Concinian processes, so I don't enter the motivation. Okay, so here is an example of the complex. So I took the tripod, so it's a graph just with one vertex in the center and just three legs. And in blue, you see all possible tubes, okay? And in red, you see all maximal tubings, so all maximal sets of compatible tubings, okay? So the blue are the vertices of the complex, and the red are the facets of the complex. And here you see the complex embedded in R2, and with this picture you already see that this corresponds to polytope, and here is the polytope you obtain. Okay, so is it clear the definition? So this is what I want to realize, and let me tell you some little bit of motivation why I call it a graph as a shahedron. The reason why we call it a graph as a shahedron is that if you take this graph as a shahedron when G is a path, then what you obtain is precisely the as a shahedron. So there is a clear bijection between the tubings here and let's say the triangulations, or it's even easier to see with parentizing of the of a word. So this gives you an as a shahedron. And the construction that I would give is actually gives you exactly the construction of Lode. Maybe we skip this one. I don't want to speak about that one, but I want to tell you that if I start from G being a complete graph, I'm not sure you see the details here, but you see I started from a complete graph. If you start from a complete graph, then the tubes they are all subsets, okay? And if you want them to be compatible, then they have to be nested. So if I want to give you a maximal nested set here, I just have to give you the order in which the tubes are given. In other words, I give you a permutation of the vertices. So you see at least that the vertices of this polytope should correspond to the permutations. And if you think a little bit more, then you see that these two polytopes have to be the same combinatorial. Okay, so this is the motivation. So I still have 10 minutes to show you what I did. And what I did, it comes in two questions. So two natural questions which I try to answer. So the first question is, okay, I told you that you have the permutahedron, as one of the graph associahedron is a permutahedron. Another one is the associahedron, which I explained you can obtain by deleting facets from the permutahedron. So the question is, which graph associahedron can I actually realize by removing facets from the permutahedron. So I call that a remover hedron. So it's start from the permutahedron and just delete facets, delete inequalities. Which kind of graph associated can you obtain? And the answer is in green here, so I can obtain these two, for example, but not this one, which I didn't describe, which is a cyclohedron. And this question, so it's also written here. I don't tell you the answer because this is what I will present in Seoul, so I let you some suspense. And what I will talk about today is the second question. So I showed you that you can realize the associahedron by many, with many different ways, with this Olweck and Lange construction. And the question is, can you do the same for graph associahedron? And I have a partial answer for trees right now. So I will start from G being a tree. And this is why it's called a sine tree associahedron. So I start from a tree, G, so T, now it's called T. So it's here on the left. And each vertex I decide whether it's a plus vertex or minus vertex. Okay, so it's why I call it a sine tree. So it's a tree on a sine ground set. So the minus signs are in white, and the plus vertices, so the minus vertices are in white, and the plus vertices are in black. And I will define some trees on T, so they are called spines, just to not make confusion with T. So a spine on T is something like this. So it's a directed and labeled tree. So the vertices are labeled by subsets of the ground set V, and the first rule is that the labels here, they have to partition the label set on the left. Okay, so you have a partition of the ground set by the labels, and the second rule is a local rule. So if you look at a vertex here, so this node, for example, and you just keep the negative vertices in this node, so 3 and 5 are the negative vertices, and you now look at this tree and delete 3 and 5, so you still have 8, 4, 9, 1, 2, 0, and 6, 7. And now in this spine, the nodes, the children that you see, so you have 4, 9, and 0, 1, they should belong to different connected components of the tree here where I deleted 3 and 5. So here it works. So 0 and 1 are in that component, 0, 1, 2. And 4 and 9 are in that component. So the rule is okay. And so I did it for the, so this is what is written here. So I did it for the minus signs, and I also have to do it for the plus signs. So if I delete 6, 7, 8 here, okay, let's do that here, it's more interesting. So here, the different connected components, so the children belong to different connected components of the tree where I delete 3. So I have 0, 1 is in that component, 5 is in that component alone, and 4, 9 is in that component. And now if I delete 6, 8, 6 and 8, then 2 and 7 are in different connected components. Okay, so this is the rule of these trees. Okay, and I have two little lemmas. You don't need to read them in details. Well, read the first one. The first one says that if you contract an edge in a spine, then you still have a spine. Okay? So you contract, and the rule is still preserved. This is the first thing. And the second thing is sort of the opposite. If you have, like here, a vertex with more than one label, I mean, with a label set with more than one element, then you can split it. So you can
contract to join the negative side to the negative side.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. Yeah, yeah. And so the second lemma tells you that if you have vertices which are still sets, not singletons, then you can split them. So what tells you is that you can define, these two lemmas tells you that you can define a simplicial complex which inclusion poset is isomorphic to the contraction poset on these spines. And this simplicial complex, because of the second lemma, is pure, and the rank is the size of the size of the ground set. So you can, this just tells you that you can open until you have trees like this. So these ones are maximal somehow in this complex. Okay? So Now, from this tree, so now I have a simplicial complex of trees, and from these trees I can define a fan. So how does it work? So let me just remind you what is a braid fan. I mean, I call it the braid fan, I'm not sure it's standard. What is true is that the braid arrangement is standard. So you take the braid arrangement in R to the V. So it's, I look at whole hyperplanes defined by this kind of equalities for different vertices U and V. So it gives you this kind of picture. This fan is a normal fan of the permutahedron. Okay? And yeah, so this is a braid arrangement, and what I call the braid fan is just the simplicial fan which is defined by this arrangement. Okay? So it looks like what I had here. So it's something which covers, it's a set of cones which covers all the space. The only little thing is that I look at that still in this hyperplane. I'm always in a co-dimension one hyperplane for some reason. Okay, so now you can coarsen this braid fan to obtain what I call the spine fan. So you see that I just I hope that you see that I start from that and delete some of the walls, and I obtain something. So what is the rule to obtain this fan? So for each of this spine, so each spine defines a cone. So the cone associated, so I don't know why I write it. Ah, it's written there. So the cone associated to a spine, so S is a spine. It's just defined as the set of vectors such that each time I see U smaller than V in spine, then I define an inequality XU smaller than XV. Okay, so it's just I have a tree, I change it to a cone. This is standard. And it gives me a set of cones. And the first theorem is that if you look at all cones, then it gives you a complete simplicial fan. So it's really something which looks like the normal fan of a polytope, which I had here. Okay, so the maximal cones, so the full dimensional cones are the cones corresponding to the maximal spines. And in particular, it proves that my simplicial complex that I defined before is a simplicial sphere, which was not at all obvious before. Okay, but even more, I will try to show you a polytope realizing this simplicial complex. So how does it work? Again, I give you two descriptions. So this description is a vertex description, and this description is a facet description. So let's go. So for the vertex description, I give you one vertex for each maximal spine. And this definition is a bit difficult to read. Let me just comment it. So the vertex associated to this span, it's the coordinates corresponding to little v. So little v is an element of the ground set. So I have one coordinate for each element of the ground set. Its coordinates, again, it's somehow the same thing. Depending, I mean, it looks like it's the same, except here I have v plus 1 minus. So before I had n plus 2 minus. You remember that I had in this Holweck and Lange construction, I had n plus 2 minus. Here I have v plus 1 minus. And the same thing, I will explain the thing afterwards. So this, whether I put v plus 1 minus or not, depends on whether v is a negative vertex or a positive vertex. So if everything is negative, then I'm sort of in Lode's case. So I don't have this v plus 1 minus. If I have some positives, then I have this v plus 1 minus. And now what I have here is something which just counts. So I have my spine. And I look at, so let me draw it here. So I have S. And I look at the vertex V in this spine. So it's a maximal spine. So each vertex is labeled just by a singleton. And I look at this vertex and let's say V right now, let's say V is in V minus. So if V is in V minus, then I have some incoming, I have some children and only one father. And then I just look at all passes. So this pi of s is for the passes. So passes in S, in the spine, Which, I mean, they have to look like this. Let me just make a picture and you will understand. So it's passes which have to pass through V. So they have to use two incoming edges of V. So this is what is written here. So this RV is that. So I don't want to use the RV, but I want to pass through V. This is what is written here. So I count these passes, and this gives me a coordinate, and then I take the convex hull of these vertices, and it gives me a polytope, you will see afterwards. The second thing that I have to define is hyperplanes. So I have hyperplanes corresponding to each, so B is what is called a building block, which I sort of jumped. So building blocks corresponds to the, so when I have a spine, I just look, for example, I pick one edge and I look at the source set of this building block. Okay, so I pick one edge and I look at the source of this edge. So everything below this edge. This is why it's called B. And associated to such a B, I have a hyperplane defined as before. Okay? So let me show you examples. I hope you can read even if you're far away. So on the left, I should stop, my time is over, but let me just write it. On the left, it corresponds to this tripod. So I think 2 is in the middle. So everything is negative, and on the right, it's the same tripod except the 2, which is still in the middle, is now positive. Okay? So it gives you 2 different complexes. So let's look at this one. So for each one, for each, so I computed all possible spines, maximal spines on this complex, and for each spine I computed the vertex coordinate. Okay? And then I took the convex hull and give me this picture. And here is the facet coordinate. So here are the building blocks which I sort of jumped before. So these are the B's somehow. So I computed all possible B's, and for each B I have a hyperplane. And this hyperplane is a hyperplane of the permutahedron. And what you should see from here to here is that I have the same polytope. And here is a theorem. And I will finish with that. So the theorem says that if you take the convex hull of these points, or if you take the intersection of these hyperplanes, then you get the same polytope. And this polytope, its normal fan is the spine fan, which I defined before. So this polytope is a realization of the nested complex, the sine nested complex, which I defined before. So here's the proof. I will jump the proof. And I was almost to the pictures, so I will also jump the pictures. The pictures give you some more geometric properties, which I discussed before for the associahedron. So this kind of properties that you can obtain. So we saw that you can obtain the permutahedron, the sine tree associahedron from the permutahedron, and you can see many things like in relation between these two polytopes. So I hope you will be motivated to go to see this paper, and I thank you very much for your attention.